Hello, I'm your presenter on the issue of internet governance. In this session, I'm going to be talking about the problem and scope of internet governance. My name is Ang Peng Hua. I'm from Nanyang Technological University. I was with the Working Group on Internet Governance for the 2004-2005 period when we came out with the report. So what I'm going to present will come out of this report as well. Essentially, I'm going to cover here just talking about the problem and scope of what internet governance is about. And briefly, we're going to talk about the history of internet governance and how it came about and what's so important about it. Then I'm going to talk a bit about the fundamental technical problem of the root zone. Following that, I'm going to talk about the World Summit on Information Society, because they gave rise to the Working Group on Internet Governance and in turn gave rise to this whole greater awareness about internet governance. Then we'll give an example of a domain name that got into some issues, the .iq or Iraq domain name, they got into some issues. And then in this session, we're just talking about definition of internet governance. We're going to end on that note. Okay, on internet governance in this session, I'm going to be talking about history and context. And then I'm going to raise some issues so that you are more aware of what internet governance is about. Because this was said to be an issue that the rest of the world could not really understand, except for those that were more developed. And so it's important to raise awareness in this issue of internet governance. Okay, for this session, we'll ask the question, what is so big, what is the big deal about internet governance? What is at stake? And how did it come about that this issue is now so big at this point in time? And then, of course, the Working Group on Internet Governance. Okay, now what is at stake here is this issue of the information society. And in this particular case, the so-called resources, the resources of the internet. Now, for resources, there is no physical resource on the internet. So the issue is not the physical resources that the internet may have, for example, wires running through under the ground, but really some technical resources. And along with that, the question now is, who controls the infrastructure placed on the internet? Some of it's international, but a lot of it is national. And if there is no understanding of how this infrastructure is to be controlled, then it is possible for national infrastructure to be controlled by some international body. So at stake is the issue of control, to a large extent control, and also national sovereignty. Now, if you look at the internet, we all know that it is run at some level by the USA. And so the question is, what happens to a country's internet if the country goes to war with the USA? Can the US in some form, in some manner, cut off the internet to this country? Well, the example is that of .iq or the Iraq domain name. Before the war in Iraq, the domain name was actually pulled off. In other words, Iraq did not exist on the internet. And the way it was done was not through national intervention, in other words, not by the US government directly, but the Iraq domain name was actually controlled by Palestinians who were living in the USA. And in that case, what happened is that the domain name owners, there's a group of them, the brothers, and working with a person called Bayan Ilashi. He was jailed for unauthorized transactions of IT equipment. And there, what happened is that the Iraq domain name was pulled off because the Iraq domain name, .iq, could not go live. And so then the issue is, what happened in such a case? So it was taken offline. Okay, the .iq domain name registry was taken offline. And in fact, it was given back to the Iraqi government only in July 2005. So there was a three-year gap when the Iraq domain name could not be reached. In other words, you couldn't register .iq, and if you were on .iq, you could not get onto your site. The Iraq domain name was given back just before the WGIG report, WGIG, the Working Group on Internet Governance report, was made public. So you can see there was some pressure there to have this matter resolved. So now this is kind of an issue that is loom large. So let me now rewind and go back to 1998, why it was such a low profile initially, and why, you know, the Iraq domain name gives an idea why the issue is now big. Going back to 1998, what happened was that there was little government interest at the time of the internet. In fact, there was a meeting in 1998 in Singapore. I was at a meeting, and the issue there is, how can we run the internet in a, you know, an open way, so that it is not under one authority. And I think governments at that time were not aware of this issue. In fact, 45 invitations were sent out, and only three people turned up, three governments turned up. Singapore and Malaysia, because they're close to each other, and then India turned up. But the rest of the 42 countries did not turn up at all. There was little interest. This meeting was the precursor to this thing called ICANN, the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers. And ICANN is the one that now controls the domain names, the .iqs, .com, and so forth, all around the world. Government interest began to change from 1998, and there are two major reasons here at that time. First was this ITU, International Telecommunications Union. They had a big meeting in Minnesota, and this idea of having this internet governance discussed came about. And this is when the World Summit of the Information Society was mooted. The Telecom Union, ITU, was the one that controls the telephone numbers. So in other words, when you dial a country code and then the telephone numbers, the system is managed at the top level anyway by ITU. They're the ones who assign the country codes. And so it looked kind of similar to the internet domain names, the IP addresses. And so people felt, well, maybe there's some similarity there. So ITU had some interest. Secondly, there was a change in the environment, the dot-com boom in 2000. And so people wanted to be part of it because it looked like there was a real economy there at the time of the dot-com boom. People were making a lot of money, hundreds of millions of dollars on sites that had literally very little revenue. But there was a dot-com boom. However, the back of it also was concern about U.S. dominance, that one country was the one that's really dominant, and then what's going to happen to the rest of us? Are we being left behind? Will they somehow dominate in some way? So there's some issues there. These are the kind of background issues. But there is a technical issue here, and this you need to understand the technical problem called the root zone problem. Now what happens is that many people think that the internet cannot be regulated at all. But I've given you a slide, and this slide took many hours actually to prepare. And to understand this, you have to see how you actually search. So let's say you search for a site like google.com. Okay? When you search for google.com, first the site, you will actually look for a root server called the .com server. Okay? Then you will come to, then the .com server will tell you that you will look for a Google server. Okay? And then the Google server will then tell you that you must look for this page. So if first you go to this root server that tells you .com, then .com tells you to go to Google. Now the control of the US ICANN, for example, is at all these server levels, the root server being key, and there are, well, maybe 13, although now they are what they call mirrored around the world. It's not in one physical location now, they're all mirrored. The .com server is also assigned by ICANN. The Google server, the numbers there are also assigned. And so you see that all of these are controlled at some level. The way to look at it is that the internet is like a telephone directory there. You cannot have two numbers repeated because then you have a conflict and you're not able to get the server that you want. So the internet at some level, although the content appears to be hard to control, even impossible to control, at the level, or at the technical level, there is some control. You need one person to tell you the number, the root server number. This is an important point here. Anyway, the point about this is that you can see that there is a control here at the various levels. You have now your .org, .id, your country codes there, and then within the country codes, government now control it. These methods of government control, I will discuss a little more, was what was at stake at the internet governance meetings. So the root zone problem is this. There is one, what I showed is 13 servers, there's actually one hidden server, and it's hidden because it's hidden from hackers. So there is one server hidden from hackers, so that you will not, there's no way that you can disrupt the internet. This has the root zone file. Not a very big file, okay, but it's got kind of all the numbers that tells you where to go, where .com goes to, where your country code would be, where would you go to, if you're Indonesia, your .id, if you're India, .in, Singapore.sg, where would you go to? This server is in the USA. And so technically, if they want to cut it off in the time of war, it is possible to cut it off, which means that your country code could be cut off. So this is obviously, it's not a technical problem, it's a political problem. And so this is the big reason why for internet governance, this issue has arisen. And I'll talk a bit about how this was resolved. Now, at the actual operational level, APDIP, Asia-Pacific Development of Information Program, did a survey. They call it, it's somewhat awkward name, or Online Regional Dialogue on Internet Governance. And they found that people were actually quite happy with ICANN and how it worked. In other words, again, the actual working of it is not a real problem. However, everybody said they wanted a say in ICANN. In other words, ICANN is doing fine, but there could be issues that we want to have an interest in, we want to say something, so you know, we want some way to get in. That's the public view. Privately, you know, when I spoke to many of these officials, they said that actually they're quite happy that you know, the internet is working. The US was quite generous, in fact, in sharing this invention with the rest of the world. So there are two levels here. One is that, you know, the public face, and one is the private face. And so this is where we have some tensions here. A second issue that is major about internet governance is concern of internet resources, and in particular that of IP addresses. Now, to understand IP addresses, you have to understand that every time you connect to the internet, you need a number. It's like a phone number. A mobile phone number, you can only have one number there. So every computer has one unique number. Now, in the past, because this was a US invention, it was given out quite freely. And in fact, US universities such as MIT had more IP addresses than China. So you can imagine if you're in China, you'd be a bit concerned that, hey, you know, will you run out of these IP addresses? For the version that we have had, IPv4, there is a limit, about 4 billion addresses. However, if MIT, for example, has given back a number of these IP addresses. They're not being used, they are being given back. So to some extent, this issue about internet resources is being played down. It was a big issue before, it is much less an issue. And one of the ways to solve it is to use technology. In this case, IPv6. So IPv4, you have about 4 billion addresses. IPv6, I can't even begin to pronounce how many zillions or trillion that is. But you can see that's enough you know, addresses to go around. So there are technical solutions to some of these internet governance problems. And now in my other lectures, I'll talk a bit about how you can solve some of these issues using technology, not necessarily using discussions or negotiations. Now, I mentioned earlier that the ITU was interested in internet governance, and also that the US seemed to be dominant. There was another group that was also interested in this information society meeting, and this was the Arab world, and led in particular by Tunisia. And the Arab world had this, being in this unusual situation where they were quite rich, you know, not all of them certainly, but you know, many of them, they had oil. However, the world seemed to be moving towards information, and so the Arabs were asking themselves, are we being left behind? The oil will run out one of these days. But information, well, it seems like it will grow on and on. Can we do something about that so we're not left behind? Now, Tunisia had led in the late 70s, early 80s, this thing called the New World Information Communication Order, or what is called NUICO. And the information minister of Tunisia at the time, Mazmouri, played a key role. And the idea there was try to balance this information flow. Now, internet governance seemed to be somewhat like that, at least at the time. And so Tunisia played a big part. And in fact, for spearheading this effort, they were given the honor of leading, having the first internet governance meeting in the country. ITU, I mentioned, was interested, and ITU, the interesting thing was that they bet on the wrong technology at the time. It's kind of interesting how these things work. Suppose I gave you a choice. You have a smart technology. Okay, this telephone system is very clever. If there's a break in the system, the telephone system will repair itself. And I give you a technology called a dumb technology. The dumb technology cannot repair itself. It's called the internet. And if there's a break, you must go around and find a new network. Now I give you a choice, a smart technology and a dumb technology. And you have to choose. Which one will you choose? I'm sure most of you will say a smart technology. I mean, you know, we're smart, right? However, as it turned out, the telephone technology, ATM at the time, asynchronous telephone transfer mode, was the wrong technology. It could go far, but couldn't go far enough. The dumb technology was the one that actually went far. That's the internet as we know it. So ITU had bet on the wrong technology, and so now they're trying to switch to get back to the internet. So there are also some technology issues there. And then, of course, I mentioned the .IQ domain name. So you can see all these forces came together to bring forward this internet governance meeting and this WSIS meeting. Now, the World Summit on Information Society in 2003 was interesting. There are two things that are very interesting that you should note. First of all, the first meeting in 2003 was a near failure. In other words, the meeting almost collapsed because there was a clash. The big issue that came up was internet governance. Who controls the internet? Why must it be the USA? How come other countries cannot play a part in it? So there was a major clash. The US in the end sort of gave in, and then that's how the internet governance meeting came about. There are a couple of levels of clashes, you could say. Of course, you could say, well, the US versus the rest of the world. That's one view. And on history, looking back, you can say that maybe it was the Bush administration, because they tended to have an imperialistic view of the world. You did many things unilaterally. So you could say simplistically that. But there's also a clash at the level of how governments work, because what happened is that non-government entities, such as civil society and the private sector, wanted to have a say in internet governance. Now, before this, you would think that governance would be in the hands of government. But with this, what was interesting was that private sector and civil society said, so, hey, hang on a minute, we want to have a say in this as well. So there was a clash at that level. And then you could say also there was a clash at the level of visions of governance. How do you see the internet? Is it run by formal rules, or can it be run by informal rules? So there are a couple of levels of clashes of internet governance here. Which has almost failed, and like I said, the US gave in. So it's interesting that there is a second summit, you know? I think, as far as I know, I'm told that this is the only event in the world where you have had two summits. Because at the world level, when a summit, it's always just one summit. You never ever have two summits. So to have two summits say something about the significance of this this matter. The first summit in 2003, and then second summit in 2005. Now, in the 2003 meeting, the conclusion was this, that first, many countries around the world, in fact, I would say the rest of the world, wanted to discuss internet governance. The US view, and eventually they compromised, the US view was that, hey, you know, you guys don't know what internet governance is about, how can you even discuss the issues? So as compromise, a working group on internet governance was formed. We were appointed by the UN Secretary General. I was one of the 40 people appointed, and then we reported to the Secretary General. Now, the UCS declaration, I've put it on the slides for you. You can see that they asked the Secretary General to set up a working group, and this comprised of, and you should note, governments, and not just government, but private sector and civil society. So the whole point is to encompass really all the stakeholders around the internet. Now, what is internet governance? The ITU view was that internet governance was ICANN issues, Internet Corporation for Assigning the Names and Numbers. And this ICANN has to do with domain names and numbers. And ITU knows numbers because the telephone number, you know, was what ITU to a great extent controlled. However, those of us in the working group, we basically rejected that view. And I mean, I personally think also it's the most sensible view. The internet governance is governance of the internet. Okay, of course, but it's more than just governance of the internet. It's more than just ICANN issues and more than just names and numbers. Okay, and the issues we'll talk about that more. Now, what is internet governance? It is not government. Okay, internet governance is not internet government. It's really the principles, the policies, the rules, processes, procedures, all around administration of the internet. Okay, it's not only the government that is involved, but also private sector and civil society. Okay. So it affects many parts of the internet. So we're talking about all the rules, okay, all the procedures, okay, and not just concerning the content, but also infrastructure. And then we put in also the transactions, meaning like, for example, e-commerce. So this definition is very important because we have basically rejected the narrow definition by the ITU Secretary General. And so what we're saying is that this internet governance issues encompasses important, very significant public policy issues, such as, and I mentioned that, spam, privacy, crime, online crime, security, and then development of the internet. Okay, so that is one major issue. The second issue is this, that it includes private sector and civil society. Now, ITU tended to be dominated by governments. Not always, but tended to be, because it represents telephone companies. And certainly in the past, telephone companies were government entities. So now we are saying that it's not just government, but also the private sector and civil society as a part of internet governance. So it's quite a significant break from what ITU had been doing. So now, just to wrap up this point here, the implications of internet governance. What we're saying is that internet governance is more than the law passed by parliament. It is not just government. Okay? It is not just government activities. It includes the norms of the internet, includes markets as well, market forces, includes the architecture, the way the internet is organized. And then the procedures and processes for internet governance should be transparent. It should be democratic. It should include multi-stakeholder and multilateral. Multilateral meaning include many countries. So in other words, the whole process should be clear to people. It should be the dominant majority should have a big say in this. It should include as many stakeholders as possible and include the countries as well. And the point about internet governance is that it shows the importance of the process of internet governance.